Welcome back, bros. This is going to be my full Marvel Hawkeye Episode 3 video. There were a whole bunch of Easter eggs and a lot more Daredevil references that we have to talk about. So if you're brand new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to get all the videos. I'm doing videos for all the episodes. We're doing a Disney Plus giveaway for memberships. All you have to do to enter is be a subscriber and leave your favorite moment from the episode in the comments. So careful for spoilers if you have not seen the episode yet, because there's a whole bunch to talk about. We'll just start at the beginning of the episode and work our way through shot by shot, talking about Easter eggs, WTF moments as we go along, starting with the episode title, Echoes, which is obviously a reference to Maya Lopez's Echo character. We get a little bit of her origin story, and her father is actually credited in the rest of the episodes for the season, so I think we'll keep getting flashbacks to his character in the past. But as I said during my episode 2 video last week, Echo is a core Daredevil comic book character with deep ties to Kingpin. There were also a couple of moments in this episode that seemed like they were directly referencing Kingpin's character. They made a couple changes to her origin story, but basically this whole intro is meant to be her version of the Kate Bishop origin story that we got during Hawkeye Episode 1. And we start with her as a child trying to make it through a day at her school with a bunch of regular kids, but she's deaf. So as we learn later from her father, she's basically trying to hide the fact that she's deaf, but also somehow try to find a way to integrate with the rest of the class successfully. If it wasn't clear what was going on with her teacher thought that she was ignoring her, because it sounds like her father purposefully wants to hide the fact that she's deaf from everyone at the school so that they don't make her go to a different school, because he can't afford to send her to the deaf school. So they just want to show you how much she feels like an outsider, not being able to participate in the conversations with these other little kids, as if she grows up not really having any big friends. And this sort of feeds into her comic book special abilities, but she learns to watch very carefully. Like, she learns because she has to learn to lip read, but that also translates to her fighting ability as she learns karate. The same way that Kate Bishop had that montage learning to use a bow and arrow, Echo basically gets the same montage, only learning martial arts and fighting skills. The person playing her father is Zahn McClarnon, who most of you will remember either from Westworld, from Longmire. He's been in a ton of movies, a ton of TV shows, so you probably recognize him from somewhere. They just want to show you that she had the same relationship with her father that Kate Bishop had with her father. Like, they're meant to be parallels for each other. But obviously we find out that he was part of the tracksuit mafia. The funny thing about their whole conversation with the dragons, she asks if dragons are real. We know that they're real because of Thor Ragnarok, and we just saw the Great Protector Dragon in the Shang-Chi movie, even though it's a dragon from a different dimension. But her father says that dragons live in a different world. He's not wrong, technically. And even though he's using the metaphor of the dragon as a metaphor for Echo having to learn to be in two worlds, be a deaf person, but also integrate with the rest of her school so that she can make it through a regular school, his conversation is basically a recap of the Shang-Chi movie. He's kind of talking about the Great Protector Dragon, which actually would have come into our dimension chasing the Dweller in Darkness had it been able to successfully break into the main MCU dimension. Like, all this stuff that he's talking about sounds very familiar. Oh, because we just got done watching it happen in the Shang-Chi movie. When she starts clocking the other little kid's moves so that she knows how to beat him instantly when they start their fight, that's just more of her comic book ability, echoing people's moves. The reason why she's called Echo is obviously a reference to her being deaf, but also a reference to her comic book ability to copy people's moves on the fly. It's kind of like a Taskmaster ability, like she instantly is able to read other people's moves and use those against them. You notice that her father is wearing a tracksuit, confirming that he is part of the tracksuit bros. And when he says her uncle will take her home after class, and then a hand reaches out and gives her this affectionate pinch on the cheek, which she smiles at, and you hear this chuckle, it actually sounds, and it seems like this is Vincent D'Onofrio's Kingpin character, like he is the mysterious uncle who gets referenced several times during the episode. Don't upset Uncle. Uncle will be very pissed off if we create too much attention for ourselves. Hawkeye says there's a man above Echo that you don't want to mess with who will do anything to grow the organization. That sounds like Kingpin. You also notice during her fight here with this little kid, she does have an artificial leg. So I'm wondering, even though they didn't make it totally clear, if she actually lost her leg during the Battle of New York, if it was just a big accident that she got into when the Chitauri attacked. I think they're just trying to draw more parallels between her experiencing that trauma and Kate Bishop experiencing that trauma and how it affected their lives. But in the comics, Echo was born deaf, so I don't think they're trying to pin her deafness on the Battle of New York. Then they cut to present day the same way they sort of flash to present day for Kate Bishop and show you how her skills have evolved. She's a much better fighter, way better at reading people. I believe the gym she's training in is also supposed to be in Hell's Kitchen, but it's not Daredevil's gym. That was Fogwell's gym. The old gym his father used to train at as a boxer. But this is a boxing ring, and there's a quote about boxing behind her. So I think it's just another subtle Daredevil reference, because this is all happening in Hell's Kitchen, prime Daredevil territory, and there's so many ties to Kingpin's character. The auto repair shop that she rides her bike to has a sign in red that says Fat Man. I believe that's another Kingpin Daredevil reference. And I think it's implied that this is where the tracksuit's base at this time in history was at during that 5-year time jump. And she's arriving just as Ronan is going through killing upper management, as Hawkeye later explained. She watches as Ronan kills her father. And it winds up being her big call to action, the same way that Kate Bishop was inspired by the Battle of New York, her father's death, and then seeing Hawkeye be this big hero on the ledge. Only it's a dark, twisted version of that, swearing revenge against Ronan. He makes another dragon reference as he lay dying, tells her to fly away, little dragon. So basically what they've done here for her origin is they've changed it so that Hawkeye Ronan was the person who killed her father instead of straight up Kingpin like in the Daredevil comics. They also make another dragon reference in present day when they're back at the warehouse getting ready to interrogate them, when the other tracksuit bro comes up making Imagine Dragon references, talking about the problems that he's having with his girlfriend because of the concert. Kate Bishop playing sort of a relationship doctor for them. The doctor's in session, like he's really excited to have her help him write the apology letter. As if there's no impending threat of death, they're like they're all just having a good time here. When Echo walks in, she instantly clocks Hawkeye's hearing aid, which the tracksuit bros had not noticed, and starts speaking sign language to him, asking what's up. And what she was saying to him when he gets super weird asking for a cookie is she was asking him why he was with Kate Bishop, because they believe she's Ronan, so he just pretends not to understand her, like, I would love another cookie, please. They finally give Kazi some bigger scenes, acting as an interpreter for Echo, and they also explain later at the end of the episode that he's basically the only tracksuit bro who bothered to learn sign language. When she chides him for relying on tech too much, she's talking about Hawkeye using hearing aids, like, you might be better without it. Talking about how she is better without hearing aids, like she herself is deaf and does not use hearing aids. He then turns it into a joke about using a bow and arrow as his go-to weapon of choice, which is about as low-tech as you could get next to punching someone like the Hulk. Then they get into some Avengers Endgame backstory, arguing about the Ronan costume, because he tries to tell her that Ronan can't be back because he's dead. Black Widow got him, which is a reference to Black Widow metaphorically killing Ronan when she was able to bring Clint back from darkness. So technically he's not lying, but she doesn't believe him when he says that he knows it's true because he was there and saw the death of Ronan and Black Widow, because Black Widow died on Vormir, and I think that even though we as the audience watched it happen during Avengers Endgame, the general public probably doesn't have all the information about everything that happened during that movie. Like, they know about the big battle with Thanos at the Avengers compound because most people witnessed it on the news. But the Avengers probably didn't disclose everything that happened during their time heist and everything that happened on Vormir, so they don't know the truth of Black Widow's death. But Hawkeye basically uses this plan to distract the tracksuits long enough to allow Kate Bishop to escape. He makes pretty quick work of them, but Echo, like I said, is able to give him some trouble just because he loses the hearing aid, which she smashes, and she's way better deaf, so it's kind of like giving him a huge debuff in their fight, until he gets his bow and arrow back. The funny thing is that in present day, at least, this is the first time we've actually seen him use the bow and arrow, mostly because this series is meant to be a Kate Bishop origin story as her version of Hawkeye from the comics, so they want to show her learning the ropes, him teaching her all these tricks, including the trick arrows, which they use for a lot of comedic moments later on during the big car chase. Don't worry, I'll talk about all those trick arrows, because there were some pretty cool ones. He does land a couple cool trick shots during this big fight scene as they're escaping, like he nicks Kaze's ear while at the same time freeing Kate Bishop. I love the ball pit takedown, but the idea is that since he's got his bow and arrow back now, he's in his element, he's able to take down everyone pretty easily. The whole joke about the 72 Dodge Challenger is actually a big Hawkeye comic book reference for the Matt Fraction run. During that run, it was Black Widow who owned a Dodge Challenger, and then later tells Hawkeye, if you love it so much, you should go out and buy one. Later, he and Kate Bishop wind up smashing the car to pieces during their fight against the tracksuits, much to Black Widow's chagrin, but it was Black Widow's Challenger at the time. So that's why in the series, he's hotwiring the other car, saying, I'm not gonna smash up a Dodge Challenger, and why later he seems so upset when the car does get smashed, even though technically it belongs to Echo, who was trying to kill them. And the way that they filmed this whole car chase scene is a huge upgrade. It's pretty hardcore, pretty cool. It looks like they filmed it in one giant long take without any cuts. Now, sometimes when they do stuff like this, there are cuts. For example, the Daredevil hallway scene that people always talk about that they did during the Daredevil Netflix seasons. even though that's filmed to look like a one-take scene, they actually revealed that there were cuts during that. They just edited them so cleverly that it looked like a single take. So they might have used some of the same tricks for this Hawkeye scene, but you could also think of it as their version of a Daredevil hallway scene. It's just happening during a big car chase. And because it's the Tracksuit Bros, they play the Christmas music and they turn it into a bit of a comedic action sequence, using it to also show you a lot of their team-up energy, Kate Bishop and Hawkeye teaming up. Like they have this really good mentor-student vibe between the two of them, the same way you see between Spider-Man and Iron Man. Papa bless. There's a ton of jokes about all the trick arrows. The first one isn't a Play-Doh arrow, it's actually the Putty arrow. Here's a chart of all of his trick arrows from the comics. The MCU trick arrows are just a little bit different, but some of them are the same. The next one she uses is the explosive tip arrow. Then she accidentally grabs the suction tip arrow, which is only good for sticking to things. She calls it super lame, but then they pay the joke off later when Clint uses it to save their lives falling from the subway train. Kate Bishop finally admitting that it actually is a really cool arrow. The one that she uses against Kazi that grabs all the Christmas trees is just a grappler arrow designed for doing exactly what you see it doing. Hawkeye can also use that the same way that he uses the cable arrow, which is the one that he uses when they both jump off the bridge to swing to the subway train. It's exactly what it sounds like, a giant cable to help him swing from things. She uses the acid arrows on the stoplights to try and slow Echo down, and then winds up yoinking her bow out of Echo's car, so nice of her to bring it with her, using it to fire a smoke arrow with purple smoke, purple for Hawkeye, into the car to cause them to crash. Then they have another really huge team-up moment, Papa Bless, where she fires her arrow super high and he uses the Ant-Man Pym-Tech arrow to make it go super giant and crush the van. Thank you so much for those Pym particles, Ant-Man. Really appreciate it. On the subway car, the placement of this very real New York City subway ad about families moving forward having no options is kind of a funny meta reference to Kate Bishop's relationship with her mother, because we all think that her mother is connected to the tracksuits and Kingpin. And then they just have another really nice scene of them together bonding over the rest of their day, just showing you more of their student-teacher vibe that they have between them. We see our next ad for the Rogers musical on a billboard, one of many. I'm sure we'll continue to see ads for the musical as we go through the rest of the episodes. The whole scene of her helping him communicate with his youngest son, Nathan Pietro Barton, remember, named after Quicksilver, is also just meant to be another bonding moment for the two of them and kind of meant to show her what he's really like with his family. His relationship with his son also kind of reminds her about her relationship with her father. And they also use it to remind you of the ticking clock here with Christmas counting down, like his promise to make it home for Christmas. Then we find out the tracksuits are packing up the warehouse because it's compromised and Kazi's worried about creating too much attention, referencing the uncle character. Like I said, I think that that's meant to be a Kingpin reference. No. They argue about her father and she reminds him that she's in charge of their crew, tasking Kazi with learning more about Clint Barton. I think they're just building to the reveal of her learning the truth that Hawkeye really is Ronan. It's the same kind of thing with Kate Bishop's character. She's slowly connecting the dots, like she confronts Hawkeye saying that, oh, I think that Ronan is someone that's close to you and that's why you're hiding the secret. But eventually she will probably learn the truth. No, it was you. You were Ronan. They pay off that conversation they had on the subway earlier about taking Lucky the pizza dog for a walk when they go to get his hearing aid repaired. Making some more deaf jokes too, Hawk ear instead of Hawk eye. They make another joke about him taking his hearing aid out when they're at the diner so that he doesn't have to listen to her chatter. Like, wait a minute, did you have that out the whole time? When she starts talking about how her father spent his whole life trying to help people, I also think that that's setting up a big arc for a twist where they reveal what really happened with her father after the Battle of New York. Early theory is that maybe he faked his death so that she and her mother could claim the insurance money and save themselves from going bankrupt. They have another bonding moment over putting the suit on for the first time, and what he's talking about is when he became Hawkeye for the first time, not when he became Ronan. He also reminds her about the price of being a superhero, the price that all the Avengers pay, how it puts a target on your back, collateral damage, the things that you have to sacrifice, like having a normal family life, normal relationships. And they make this big joke about the classic comic book Hawkeye costume with the H on his head and the big hawk wings. If you actually watched the episode 2 LARPing scenes really carefully, you may have also noticed that one of the LARPers was dressed in the classic Hawkeye comic book costume. It's sort of the Hawkeye series version of doing the WandaVision thing with her wearing the classic Scarlet Witch comic book costume, but as a Halloween costume, like it was a costume within the context of the episode. When he tries to tell her that he's not a role model to anyone, that's just more of his guilt over the really messed up stuff that he's had to do over the years, like killing all the mob members when he was Ronin, and just all the people that he's killed in general, because he has killed a lot of people. Making another Black Widow reference, there is a lot of red on his ledger. Kate Bishop kind of tries to redeem him a little with a pep talk about how he inspired her as a little girl, that you don't need superpowers to be a hero. And they also remind us that technically she has not finished naming Lucky the Pizza Dog. She's only just called him Pizza Dog, but there's this big montage of her trying out a bunch of different names. She'll probably give him the Lucky name after another big action scene. The reason why Hawkeye named him Lucky in the comics is because he survived a huge accident. When she calls Kazi the hot guy, that's another Matt Fraction Hawkeye comic book Easter egg. During that run, I believe Kate Bishop had a brief relationship with him, but I don't think they're going to do that for the MCU series. When Kate Bishop looks at Lucky the Pizza Dog and says, "You should never get involved in organized crime," that's another reference to the Matt Fraction run, because during that, Lucky the Pizza Dog actually started out being Ivan's pet. This character here, he's like one of the lead tracksuit bros. When he wonders about the other items from the Avengers compound floating around the black market, that's another reference to the watch that the tracksuit bros were really there to steal, and obviously setting up the big twist at the end of the episode with the Hawkeye Ronin sword. They try to break into her mother's database to get info connecting Jack Duquesne, swordsman, to the tracksuits, and when they pull up Kazi's file here, anytime you notice them pulling up files with numbers and names everywhere, there's a lot of Easter eggs and references. Zoom and Enhance, Sloan Limited, created in 2011, is actually a reference to Walker Sloan from a Spider-Man 2099 video game called Spider-Man Edge of Time, which was released in the year 2011. The character was even voiced by Val Kilmer himself. Walker Sloan was the CEO of Alchemix, the company that Miguel O'Hara worked for when he became Spider-Man 2099 and got his powers. All the names on the list here on the left are just the names of the other tracksuit bros, so within the context of the Hawkeye series in the MCU, Sloan Limited is just the front organization for the tracksuits. And if it wasn't clear, these documents are basically for subcontractors of Bishop Security, confirming that they are working for Eleanor Bishop, Kate's mother. Which also kind of confirms that she was probably behind the hit on the auction trying to steal the watch. When she tries to pull up information on Jack Duquesne, swordsman, it triggers a super hardcore security protocol, implying that her mother really wants to keep those files on Jack ultra secret. That could just be more of a red herring, because I think they're still trying to play the reveal about her mother being connected to all this as this big surprise in a later episode. Like, "Oh, Mom, I never realized that you were connected to all this shady stuff." Hawkeye walks into the other room and is surprised by Jack Duquesne, who uses the Ronin sword he stole from the auction, which Hawkeye recognizes instantly, so the show wants to take us further down the swordsman rabbit hole before they reveal how her mother and Kingpin are really connected to all this. If you did spot any other Easter eggs during the episode or big Daredevil references, just write them below in the comments. My full Hawkeye episode 4 video will post next week. Remember, we're also going to be seeing Yelena Belova show up on the series, probably episode 4, episode 5. I don't know if she's going to be in one episode or multiple episodes, but we still have that going on in the background too, so we'll probably see her pretty soon. I don't think we'll actually see Vincent D'Onofrio's Kingpin on the series in like a cameo scene till like episode 5 or episode 6. There are only 6 episodes total, so I don't think he's going to show up till a little bit later. I've got a couple special Spider-Man videos that I'm working on this week, so those should post pretty soon. If you have any other big requests, just write them below in the comments. Everyone click here for my new Spider-Man No Way Home trailer video and to learn about the new Spider-Man trilogy that they just confirmed with Tom Holland, Spider-Man 4, 5, and 6, and click here for all my Hawkeye episode videos. Thank you so much for watching. Everyone stay safe, and I'll see you in the next one, bros.